Welcome. In this video, I am going to explain the concept of cointegration and I will show how it is estimated. I will discuss its theory a little bit and then I will give some numerical examples. So, this is today's video. I am discussing cointegration and its estimation using its theory and numerical examples. Let me start with the my topic, that is cointegration. In order to answer the question, what is cointegration? Let us suppose we have two time series, one is XT and one is YT. And let me also suppose that XT is a series of consumer price index or inflation rate and YT is the series of unemployment rate. Let us suppose both of these series are non-stationary at level and but they have the property that there is some linear combination of them, say for example XT minus alpha YT is stationary. If this property holds, then it implies that XT and YT are co-integrated, they have co-integration, that is they have long-run relationship. Two co-integrated series will not drift too far away from each other over the long run. Examples could be like consumption and income, price of two clothes, substitutes, prices and wages into related markets and so on. The analysis of the short-run dynamics is often done by first eliminating the trends invariable, that is detrending the data, and that can usually be done by differencing. This procedure, however, wastes some of the potential valuable information. For example, long-run relationships about which economic theories have a lot to say. Think of two series again, series XT and YT, and they are integrated of order 1. So if these two series are co-integrated, then XT and XT plus phi are also co-integrated. If two series are co-integrated, they also have Granger causality. However, we cannot know the direction of the causality, but we can test whether X Granger's Y or Y Granger's Y, X are both Granger's each other. We can detect co-integration using one of these three approaches. One is Engel-Granger approach. The second one is Johansen Cointegration approach and the third one is autoregressive distributed leg or ARDL approach. Granger causality. Granger published a paper in 1969 and that was the first attempt at testing for direction of causality. Let us suppose that X Granger causes Y, but Y does not Granger cause X, then it means that the past values of X should be able to help us predict the future values of Y, but the past values of Y should not be helpful in forecasting or predicting the future value of X. We are now going to use Engel-Granger 1987 test for causality, and it has a number of steps. Step number one is that we will first test the variables for stationarity. If they are stationary at level, then the usual OLS estimation is appropriate. If they are not stationary in the same degree, then we will go to step two. And step two is here. We can estimate equation like YT is equal to beta 1 plus beta 2 XT plus UT, where UT is the disturbance term, XT is independent time series, and B2 is its coefficient, beta 1 is its intercept, and Yt is the dependent time series. And the command in time series is LSY constant, C for constant, and X. And the step number 3 is, if the residual is stationary, that is, it is integrated of order 0, then we conclude that the two variables are co-integrated. Let me show you graphs of our variables. On the left hand side, the top graph is labeled as LNINF. This is the log of inflation, and the bottom graph shows the log of unemployment, and on the right hand side it is difference log of inflation, and in the lower graph it is difference log of unemployment. But if you look at these two graphs, on the left hand side log of inflation rate has a downward trend. There are some ups and downs, but overall this series shows a downward trend. Similarly, the log of unemployment, it has also some ups and downs, and the overall trend is positive in this. But if you look at the difference series of inflation and unemployment, they become stationary when we difference these two series. So it means these two series are non-stationary at level, but they become stationary when we difference the data. So here are some examples. Here we are testing for stationarity. So at level with no trend and no intercept, log of inflation has a unit root. Then at level with trend and intercept, the log of inflation rate has the unit root. At level and with only intercept, again the log of inflation has a unit root. But if we difference the data, that with only intercept, the series become stationary. Similarly, if we take the case of log of unemployment at level with no trend and no intercept, the series is non-stationary. And at level having trend and intercept, the series of log of unemployment rate is also having a unit root. And if we include only intercept at level, then the data or the series log of unemployment has a unit root. But if we take the first difference and with the intercept only, the data become stationary. So it means that both the series, that is unemployment and inflation, become stationary when we difference the data, but they are non-stationary at level. So our conclusion is that both inflation and unemployment series are stationary of the same degree, that is I1. So we can go to step 2, and if we run the regression, here are the results. But let me use my own data. I have the data here, and let me go to equation and equation box. I will use log inflation C log unrate, which is unemployment rate, and if I press OK, so here is my estimated model. The total number of observations are 501. The dependent variable is log of inflation. The method is least square. And this is sample adjusted. So the coefficient of log of unemployment is minus, although it is insignificant. It shows like the negative relationship as specified by the Phillips curve. So now let me check the residual. I have already made the residual, which are there, resid 01. But we can go to proc and make residuals, make, if you press this, make residual series, then give the name. Say for example, I give now name resid 02 because resid 01 is already there. So it will make residual. So these are basically the same, exactly the same. So now I will check, okay, I just made this. Let me view its unit root and at level with none, and it is automatically using Schwarz information criteria with a maximum lag of 17. Pressing OK. This is a ADF test, and well, it says that the residual of the regression that I just used, that is the log of inflation, was regressed by the log of unemployment, and it says that we are rejecting the null hypothesis that residual of the regression has a unit root. So it means that these residuals are stationary. So our conclusion is that these two series, that is the inflation rate and the unemployment rate, has a co-integration. So this is also the way that how can we create residual. But the method that I use is more simple. And here in this, the p-value shows that the residuals are stationary, they don't have a unit root. So we conclude that the UT are the error term, are the residual, estimated residuals series is stationary. So according to Engel-Granger test, log of unemployment and log of inflation series are co-integrated. So this is about Engel-Granger test. And we can also use the Johansen approach. If the model has two variables, then there can be more than one co-integration relation. Generally, for m number of observations, we could have m minus 1 number of co-integrating vectors. Now, assume that all the variables are endogenous in the model, and no need to choose any variable for normalization. So in the Johansen co-integration approach, we will determine first the co-integration integrated degree for the number of m variables by the unit root test. Most of economic indicators are non-stationary. Using the unit root test also prevents the spurious regression problem. So first of all, we will check the series for unit root. Step 2 is then we will find the appropriate lag order by using a lag length criteria using a vector autoregressive model. And this step is very important, which ensures that the error terms comes from a white noise process. The third step in this approach is that we will select the model according to the deterministic component. So here, say for example, there are two variables. One is a PDIE and one is a PDE. So if we open them as a VAR specification, and on the left hand side you see there we will use unrestricted VAR, and then after that we will go to lag structure, and then we will specify lag length criteria, and we will determine what is the lag structure. Finally, then we go for a co-integration test, and we will test Johansen system co-integration test, and we will use this one, the number 2, intercept, no trend, and these are the results. So on the basis of the trace test and the maximum eigenvalue test, it indicates that one co-integration equations at 5% level. So the trace state indicates that the null hypothesis of no cointegration is rejected at 5% level. So at most there is one cointegrating equation. So the null hypothesis of one cointegrating equation is accepted. Now we compare the Engel-Granger versus Johansen cointegration approaches. Now Engel-Granger is a manual method for the cointegration test, but its disadvantage is that it gives maximum one cointegrating equation even if there are more than one cointegrating relations. Johansen cointegration approach is superior than the Engel-Granger, but the restrictions are that the variable have to be integrated of the same order. We can also use a vector auto regression models, but in this video I am not going to discuss vector auto regression model. We can also detect cointegration using ARDL models, but in this video I am not going to discuss the detection of cointegration in ARDL model. Ladies and gentlemen, this is a brief discussion about cointegration, its theory, comparison of two approaches, that is Engel-Granger and Johansen cointegration test, and in both the methods we differentiated, like we use Engel-Granger test when we have only two variables, one is independent and one is dependent. But when we have more than one independent variables, then we are using a Johansen cointegration approach. Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, share this video with your friends, with your colleagues, so that the benefits of this video could reach to the maximum number of persons. And if you haven't yet subscribed to the channel, kindly do subscribe, and don't forget to click on the bell icon so that you can get notification about my other videos that I will upload very soon. Thanks a lot and have a good evening.